New York, this is Democracy Now!
We're sharing them in a wide range of countries within Latin America and the Caribbean, South and Southeast Asia, and across Africa in coordination with the African Union. This includes prioritizing our neighbors here in our hemisphere, including countries like Guatemala and Colombia, Peru and Ecuador, and many others.
The Biden administration's unveiled plans to send 25 million COVID vaccines abroad. But some public health experts say far more needs to be done as the pandemic continues to devastate Africa, Latin America, and Asia. We'll speak to South African public health activist Fatima Hassan and the economist Jeffrey Sachs, then to disaster patriarchy, how the pandemic has unleashed a war on women.
All over the world, the patriarchy has taken full advantage of the virus to reclaim power. On the one hand, escalating the danger and violence to women, and on the other, stepping in as their supposed controller and protector.
We'll speak to V, the playwright and activist formerly known as Eve Ensler. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Biden administration's announced plans to send 25 million COVID vaccine doses to dozens of countries in Latin America, Africa, and Asia, where new infections continue to surge. The majority of the doses will be distributed through COVAX, a program backed by the World Health Organization. National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan said Thursday the initial shipments are part of a broader plan to send a total of 80 million doses abroad by the end of June.
Our approach also prioritizes South and Southeast Asia, including countries like India, Nepal, the Philippines, and others that are undergoing surges right now. It recognizes our closest neighbors, Canada and Mexico, which received our first shared vaccines, and friends like the Republic of Korea, where our military shares a command.
Public health experts say the U.S. plan falls far short of what's needed to address the global crisis. Based on current vaccination rates, the People's Vaccine Alliance estimates it could take 57 years to fully vaccinate everyone in low-income nations. The World Health Organization is warning of a sudden, sharp increase in the spread of COVID-19 in many parts of Africa that could lead to a continent-wide wave of new infections. Cases are rising in at least 14 African nations and are up by 30% in many areas over just the last 2 weeks. Hospitals in Uganda report they're becoming overwhelmed with COVID patients, while South Africa appears to be entering a third wave of infections. The WHO warns the surge is coming as shipments of vaccines to African nations have come to a near halt. Africa has administered vaccine doses to just 31 million people out of a population of 1.3 billion, with only 7 million people in Africa fully vaccinated. We'll go to South Africa to speak with public health expert Fatima Hassan after headlines. In Hong Kong, police arrested an organizer of the annual candlelight vigil commemorating the June 4, 1989 massacre at Tiananmen Square, which has been banned this year. 32 years ago, the Chinese military attacked a student-led pro-democracy protest in Beijing, killing hundreds, if not thousands, of people. Authorities say the annual vigil was banned due to the pandemic, but activists say it's just another move by Chinese authorities to crack down on dissent and freedom of speech in Hong Kong. At the University of Hong Kong, students observed a moment of silence and laid flowers in front of a sculpture honoring the victims of the massacre. This is Student Union President Charles Kwok.
By holding the event, we hope to commemorate the people who sacrificed for freedom and democracy. And then we hope to defend the historical truth, given that our freedom of speech and the truth is dwindling.
In Peru, voters are set to vote Sunday in the runoff presidential election between leftist candidate Pedro Castillo, a former teachers' union leader, and the right-wing Keiko Fujimori, the daughter of former President Alberto Fujimori. This is Pedro Castillo at a recent debate with Fujimori.
Vamos a recuperar la riqueza como la renegociación.
We are going to recover our wealth by renegotiating contracts with large companies, with mining companies that take the country's wealth, to recover gas from the camisea, to give all Peruvians, to recover oil,
para darle a todos los peruanos, recuperar el petróleo,
How is it possible that in such a rich country there is so much misery, so much inequality, and only the biggest, the richest, profit, even those that don't work?
Midterm elections are taking place in Mexico this weekend, with the ruling party of Mexican President Andrés Manuel López Obrador and his allies favored to retain their majority. At least 89 politicians have been killed in the run-up to the election, 35 of them candidates running for Sunday's vote. Around 21,000 local and national seats are up for grabs. Mexican electoral law requires half of a party's candidates to be women. In addition, around 2% of surveyed candidates in this election identify as members of the LGBTQ community. The lawyers for a Saudi man imprisoned at Guantanamo Bay are asking a court to reverse a decision by a military judge to permit information obtained through torture by CIA interrogators. Lawyers for Abdulrahim al-Nashiri say he was tortured for 4 years at multiple black sites around the world. Nashiri is accused of plotting the attack on the USS Cole off the coast of Yemen in 2000, which killed 17 sailors. He's facing the death penalty. Nashiri's defense says that if permitted, it would be the first time evidence obtained through torture would be used in such a case. Human rights groups are accusing the Biden administration of vastly underreporting the number of civilians killed by the U.S. military in 2020. A Pentagon report made public Wednesday finds U.S. forces killed 23 civilians last year during military strikes in Afghanistan, Iraq, Somalia, Syria, and Yemen. The British watchdog group Air War says that, even by a conservative estimate, the true toll is nearly five times higher, at 102 civilian deaths. Air War says the official Pentagon count ignores the killing of 69 civilians in Afghanistan, flagged by U.N. monitors, among other shortcomings. Air Wars also says the Pentagon failed to pay out any compensation to civilians affected by U.S. attacks in 2020, even though Congress made millions of dollars available for such payments. The World Health Organization warns the Gaza Strip faces staggering health needs, with as many as 200,000 Palestinians requiring aid following Israel's 11-day bombardment of the besieged territory last month. Israel's assault damaged about 30 health facilities, destroyed 1,800 residential units, and damaged more than 14,000 other homes. The WHO is calling for unhindered humanitarian access to Gaza and for Israel to allow Palestinians to seek treatment outside Gaza whenever needed. On Thursday, top Biden administration officials welcomed Israeli Defense Minister Benny Gantz to Washington, D.C., promising ironclad U.S. support for Israel despite growing international outrage over the widespread killing of civilians, including at least 66 children, during Israel's assault on Gaza. Gantz met with Secretary of State Antony Blinken and was welcomed to the Pentagon by Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin.
I wanted to reiterate that the administration's commitment to Israel's security is ironclad. We are committed to maintaining Israel's qualitative military edge and ensuring that Israel can defend itself against regional threats such as those posed by Iran, its proxies, and terrorist groups.
Meanwhile, actions are planned across the United States, including Seattle, Oakland, Los Angeles, and New York, under the banner Block the Boat, to prevent Israeli-operated cargo ships owned by shipping giant Zim from unloading on U.S. soil as part of the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions, or BDS, movement. Zim transports Israeli weapons as well as consumer goods. In related news, the United Educators of San Francisco last month became the first American K-12 public school union to endorse the BDS movement amidst the deadly Israeli assault on Gaza. Facebook is expected to announce it will no longer allow politicians to break the social media company's rules on hate speech. The decision's based on recommendations from Facebook's oversight board and comes as the social media giant is weighing whether to permanently ban former President Trump from its platform over his racist comments and his incitements to violence ahead of the January 6th Capitol insurrection. Meanwhile, Mike Pence is defending his record as vice president under Trump, even while offering limited criticism of the former president. Speaking at a dinner hosted by New Hampshire Republicans Thursday, Pence called January 6th a dark day in the history of the United States.
You know, President Trump and I have spoken many times since we left office. And I don't know if we'll ever see eye to eye on that day. but I will always be proud of what we accomplished for the American people over the last 4 years.
The New York Times reports Trump has reportedly been telling people he expects to be reinstated as president by August. The FBI is investigating whether Postmaster General Louis DeJoy violated federal campaign finance laws during his tenure as the top executive at New Breed Logistics. That's according to The Washington Post, which previously reported DeJoy pressured former employees at the company into donating to Republican candidates before paying them back with large bonuses. DeJoy is a Republican megadonor with no prior Postal Service experience. In 2020, he imposed sweeping operational changes at the U.S. Postal Service that dramatically slowed down mail delivery ahead of the presidential election, when a record number of voters were relying on mail-in ballots due to the pandemic. And Minneapolis officials have begun clearing the memorial at the intersection where George Floyd was murdered by Officer Derek Chauvin. Early Thursday, authorities removed concrete barriers and took away flowers, artwork, and other tributes to victims of police violence. The site has become a center of protest and is informally known as George Floyd Square. Jalani Hussein, director of the Minnesota chapter of the Council on American Islamic Relations, joined protesters who said they will continue to occupy the space.
It's not the traffic that they're trying to bring through this road. It is the fact that they want to ignore the legacies that created this country, from the genocide of Native Americans to today, the mass incarceration of black people all over this country, and the continuous brutalization of black people, just as the killing of George Floyd and the many incidents that have been happening. They're not trying to drive cars through here. They're trying to delete history. But we will not let them delete this history.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Biden administration announced plans to send 25 million COVID vaccine doses to dozens of countries in Latin America, Africa, and Asia, where COVID cases continue to surge. The majority of the vaccines will be distributed through COVAX, a program backed by the World Health Organization. National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan said the administration plans to send a total of 80 million doses by the end of the month.
We're sharing them in a wide range of countries within Latin America and the Caribbean, South and Southeast Asia, and across Africa in coordination with the African Union. This includes prioritizing our neighbors here in our hemisphere, including countries like Guatemala and Colombia, Peru and Ecuador, and many others.
The Biden administration's announcement comes just before the president heads to Britain to take part in a G7 summit. Many public health experts say the U.S. plan falls far short of what's needed to address the global crisis, which has killed at least 3.7 million people, though public health researchers say the true toll is likely approaching 8 million deaths. According to the People's Vaccine Alliance, more than a million COVID deaths have occurred in the past 4 months since leaders of the G7 failed to collectively back a waiver of intellectual property rules for COVID vaccines. The United States now backs the waiver, but other G7 nations and the pharmaceutical industry continue to oppose the waiver. Based on current vaccination rates, the People's Vaccine Alliance estimates it could take 57 years to fully vaccinate everyone in low-income nations. The New York Times reports 85% of vaccine doses have gone to people in high- and middle-income countries. On Thursday, the World Health Organization warned, quote, "the threat of a third wave in Africa is real and rising." Cases are rising in at least 14 African nations over the past 2 weeks. In a moment, we'll go to Cape Town to speak with Fatima Hassan, a South African human rights lawyer and HIV/AIDS and social justice activist, founder and director of Health Justice Initiative. But first, we begin with economist Jeffrey Sachs, the director of the Center for Sustainable Development at Columbia University, president of the UN Sustainable Development Solutions Network. Jeffrey Sachs is also the author of several books, including The Ages of Globalization. He led the WHO's Commission on Macroeconomics and Health from 2000 to 2001. Jeffrey Sachs, welcome to Democracy Now! Responding to Biden's plan to immediately send out 25 million doses, then hit 80 million by the end of the month.
Well, we need a comprehensive strategy. What's happened is the United States is reaching the target levels of immunization within our own country, but the amount of production is massive. So there is a vaccine available for mass distribution around the world. The same is happening in Europe, in the UK, in China. We need a global plan. We can estimate that there are hundreds of millions of doses being produced each month now, but there is no plan for getting them to the people in need. You quoted a study that said it could take 57 years. I would put it a different way. We could get comprehensive immunization around the world, certainly within the next 12 months. Certainly, let me underscore that. And it could be even faster, given the scale of production. But we do not have an allocation plan. We don't even have transparency right now. We have the companies that have been approved. How much are they producing per month? What contracts do they have? Where are these doses going right now? How should they be allocated across the world for prioritization? This is basic stuff, but the United States is not sitting down with China, with Russia, with the European Union, with the United Kingdom, with the WHO as the overall orchestrator to make sure that there is a just, inclusive, rapid, comprehensive coverage. It's unbelievable, actually, that we don't have this sorted out. It's a matter of a spreadsheet, and it's a matter of disclosure and transparency by companies, and it's a matter of the United States talking with China, not just yelling at China. And this is what's missing right now to this moment.
So what would it actually require?
It would not require much. It would require some Zoom meetings of senior officials in China, the United States, the European Union, the United Kingdom, the United States, together with WHO, together with representatives of the producing companies, Moderna, Pfizer, BioNTech, Sinopharm, Sinovac. How many doses are you producing per month right now? What are your contractual relations, which may have to be overridden because the public sector has paid for all of this? We don't have that clarity. When I make rough calculations with my colleagues on this, we have enough production globally to get comprehensive immunization within the next 12 months. But then when I ask WHO or U.S. officials, they say, well, we don't really know exactly where Pfizer is selling. And are you kidding? We're in a global emergency of unprecedented dimension. How can you not know precisely what is happening and why is there no plan to this date?
And can you explain
that's the amazing situation.
Can you explain what the most efficient way to do this, not necessarily to send doses from the United States, but to make a deal like Biden made with Merck and Johnson & Johnson? Merck didn't develop the vaccine. Johnson & Johnson Jensen did. But Merck then also helps to reproduce that vaccine, to manufacture that vaccine. The idea that there are many pharmaceutical companies in the world that didn't develop vaccines, but if they're given the recipe the means of, it's also a lot of hardware, they can help to manufacture these millions and millions of doses that are needed.
That is correct. That's why the IP waiver is, in a way, a no-brainer right now, period. But I would say, even in addition to that, there is a production flow that is underway that is sufficient to immunize the adult population worldwide comprehensively. The mistake, Amy, is to think that this is about markets, that this is about the secret deals that Pfizer, BioNTech can make with the high-paying customers, that there's can be no transparency because that's a trade secret. This is mind-boggling. Governments have paid for all of this. We need a global distribution system for worldwide safety, not only given the fact that people are dying in surge countries, but given the fact that variants are developing in surge countries and spreading worldwide, this requires a systematic political mobilization. But in the middle of this, we have a crazy kind of Cold War that we're not speaking with China about a coordinated strategy. We don't have the main players at the table. And these days, you don't even need a table. You need a Zoom. And that's all that is needed, actually, to get this done. Financing can also be arranged. These companies also should abide by normal pricing. It's not that this should be, the word is free market. It's insane. This is not even a market. It's like auctioning seats on a lifeboat the way they're doing it right now. In other words, the most basic standards of management logic are not being applied right now, even though this is the greatest global emergency in modern history. Why is Jake Sullivan announcing just what the United States is going to do without transparency for July, for August, for September? And why is he saying it not in the context of a globally agreed plan, but of the United States announcing some number? Beats me. Because when I look at this and I'm involved in it day to day, what is needed is a strategy over 6 months. Countries need to know when doses are going to arrive. They need to have supply chains locally ready. They need to train. They need to have the capacity to get the vaccines into operation. So this is an operational challenge. It is not some market mania, which is the way that it has been treated till now, as if companies have the right and the prerogative to do what they want, sign what secret contracts they want without any disclosure. That's the situation we're in right now.
So the People's Vaccine Alliance reports profits from COVID vaccines have helped at least 9 people become billionaires during the pandemic, with a combined wealth of over $19 billion, more than enough to cover the cost of fully vaccinating all people in low-income countries. I want to bring in Fatima Hassan, founder and director of the Health Justice Initiative in South Africa, speaking to us from Cape Town. We just had in headlines the World Health Organization warning of a sharp increase in COVID-19 in many parts of Africa, cases rising in at least 14 countries. Talk about what this means, the fact that it is so difficult to get vaccines to the developing world, that it would take something like, what was the estimate, 57 years?
Yeah, thanks. And I think, you know, the previous speaker is right. We could be addressing this in the next few months if there was the political will to ensure that many of these front-runner vaccine companies would actually share the knowledge and share the vaccine know-how. In my own country, we're still waiting for supplies from Johnson & Johnson because of an issue that has arisen in the U.S., and we're waiting for FDA clearance. That has halted half of our vaccination program because we are totally reliant on supplies from 2 pharmaceutical companies who refuse to issue multiple voluntary licenses, who refuse to allow others to manufacture the vaccines, to share the knowledge, and to allow others to be able to be part of the supply chain system. So the situation that we have around the number that it will take, the number of years that it will take to vaccinate everybody in the global south, is one of artificial self-created scarcity. There aren't enough supplies because there is knowledge hoarding. And where there are supplies, they're not coming fast enough. In my own country, it's June 2021. We've only vaccinated just over 1 million people, half of whom who were part of a study trial. So that tells you there's something fundamentally wrong with the supply chain system, which is very tenuous in the world at the moment. And despite the WHO saying, you know, in the first half of 2021, let's at least use available supplies for all healthcare workers around the world or all people over 80, that has not happened. So, you know, I agree there isn't a prioritization. There's definitely a scarcity of supplies, but that scarcity can be addressed and it is self-created.
So explain how it could work in South Africa. What would it require of the wealthiest countries like the United States? I mean, you have the G7 meeting today. That's the group of 7, Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, the United Kingdom, and the United States. What do you want to see come out of that meeting? What are your demands?
So all of those countries except the U.S. are actually blocking what we call the TRIPS waiver. The U.S. has indicated partial support for the waiver only in relation to vaccine, not in relation to diagnostic technologies or not in relation to therapeutics or other kind of interventions that could actually help us manage the epidemic. For over 8 months, the G7 have been sitting on a proposal for the TRIPS waiver that would allow other manufacturers around the world, wherever there is untapped capacity, to be able to make versions of these vaccines so that we can get millions of doses into many different parts of the world. So they're blocking that while their own populations are quite, you know, advanced in terms of vaccination levels. In some parts of the G7 member states, they're actually vaccinating younger, healthy people. In my own country, people who are over 80 are still waiting for an appointment for a vaccine. So it tells you that the G7 could do a lot more. Many of them have co-invested in some of these vaccines. They actually own the technology, but they're really fearful. They are deferential to pharmaceutical and intellectual property interests. And even with the current state that we're in, with a number of countries facing a wave three, some may also be facing a wave four, with the hospitalization data that we're seeing, the morbidity figures that we're seeing, particularly in Africa, even now, countries are still sitting around a table and talking and having long conversations instead of figuring out an urgent way to ramp up manufacturing, scale up production, and get as many doses to as many people as possible all over the world.
I wanted to just share some figures that are pretty astounding. The People's Vaccine Alliance made new calculations with the Health Justice Initiative, Oxfam, and UNAIDS. They found last month people living in G7 countries were 77 times more likely to be offered a vaccine than those living in the world's poorest countries. Between them, G7 nations were vaccinating at a rate of 4.6 million people a day in May. Meanwhile, if this rate continues, everyone living in G7 nations will be fully vaccinated by January. At the current rate, 63,000 people a day, it would take low-income countries 57 years. How many millions of people had to die, Jeffrey Sachs, have to die, to make these pharmaceutical drug company billionaires?
Let me put it in a somewhat different perspective, if I might. The United States has now vaccinated more than half of the population. Sadly, we have vaccine resistance, which is another tragedy, and I'll put that aside for the moment. The U.S. has been producing hundreds of millions of doses per month. That is now available for the rest of the world. And that's why this announcement has been made. But there is no plan of allocation. A similar situation applies in Europe, though Europe is 6 to 8 weeks lagging the United States. A similar situation applies to the UK, which is also a producing country. China is producing a lot of vaccine now and getting a lot of coverage within China. What it means is that we're producing globally at a rate maybe of immunizing 500 million people a month. That's the rate if you add across the companies, roughly. That is plenty of production, but there's no plan for allocating these vaccines right now. That is unbelievable to this moment. So I think the production levels are actually high. They have gone overwhelmingly to the rich countries in the early months, but the rich countries are saturated, essentially, or becoming saturated with coverage because they have reached or close to reaching targets. And that means that this production is available for the world, which needs it urgently, where people are dying without it. But countries don't even know a target date right now. They have no idea. They're completely in the dark. Should they wait for COVAX? Should they go try to sign some agreement with Pfizer at some incredibly marked up price? Should they make side deals? Should they accept this one or that one? Nobody knows because there's no system. And I think that that is largely the fault of the United States and its failure to cooperate transparently and publicly with China, with Russia, with the European producers, with India, and with the United Kingdom. In other words, there's massive supply, but there's no plan for allocation.
Final comment, Fatima Hassan, on the issue of the vaccines and what's happening in South Africa, what's happening in Uganda, what's happening in different African countries, what people need to know on the continent and outside.
So I would say two things. I would slightly disagree. We don't think the production levels are sufficient, which is why we're having a supply crisis in almost all of Africa, which also explains that why less than 3% of people in Africa have actually received supplies and have actually been vaccinated. And COVAX is obviously not the solution. Even if the U.S. puts in a trickle of 20 million doses into COVAX, COVAX has indicated that by the end of 2021, it's only likely to cover about 27 to 30% of vulnerable populations in low-income countries. So COVAX, I think, is a tremendous failure. The supplies are not sufficient. We don't believe production levels are enough, and we really need to ramp up manufacturing through the sharing and urgent sharing of the vaccine know-how and knowledge. And, you know, the waiver is just one part of that. There now has to be moves for governments, particularly the GS member states, to compel pharmaceutical companies to share the technology and to transfer the technology as well.
Finally, is there concern that the U.S. would be sending, for example, AstraZeneca when it hasn't even approved it itself in the United States? And also the fact that even Moderna and Pfizer vaccines only have emergency use authorization. They haven't been fully approved. Do you understand the reason for that?
Are you
asking me?
Let's go to Fatima, and then I'll end with Jeffrey Sachs.
Sorry, Jeffrey, but in relation to South Africa, Moderna hasn't even submitted its regulatory dossier, so we wouldn't, for example, be able to take their supplies right now. They refuse to enter low-income countries. South Africa's taken a decision not to use AstraZeneca, so at the moment, you know, like I said in the beginning, we're reliant on Pfizer and Johnson & Johnson. So the issue of vaccine selection in Africa is as equally important, and I think Jeffrey is right. Where is the conversations with Russia and with China? We now know some dossiers from Sputnik, Sinovac, Sinopharm, Sinovac have been submitted, but there seems to be in some parts of the world a reluctance to use those vaccines and to rely primarily on vaccines that come from Pfizer and Johnson & Johnson. And that, I think, is going to be our undoing, because we certainly don't have enough supplies of vaccines to go around the world expeditiously.
Your response, Jeffrey.
Just to be clear, I agree on the need for ramping up. But what I'm saying is the reason that Africa has gotten so little, in part, is that the rich countries used all the production in the beginning. And that phase is at an end. It was not an appropriate way to do things. It was the way it was done. Now there is a massive supply that could be brought to bear. And that is the point that I wanted to make. So it's not a disagreement on what to do. It is a point that we have a massive supply coming available, but without a plan to bring it about. On the question, should AstraZeneca, should Moderna and others be used? I would say yes, from everything we know about the clinical evidence and the practical efficacy. We need to get comprehensive coverage as rapidly as possible. We are in an unprecedented crisis, but also an unprecedented situation where vaccines have come online for a new disease in a record time. Is there some uncertainty? Yes. But does that merit delay? In my view, absolutely not.
Well, I want to thank Fatima Hassan, founder and director of the Health Justice Initiative in South Africa, joining us from Cape Town, and ask Jeffrey Sachs to stay with us after break. I want to ask you about the G7 finance ministers expected to agree on support for a global minimum corporation tax, and also your criticism of President Biden for backing off of his massive infrastructure plan. What's being compromised? Stay with us.
तर प्यारे नू हाल मुरी दादा के
जाया दाओ डाना तुद बिन रोग रजा
Mitra Piarino by Sunny Singh. The song is a Sikh devotional song, often sung at funerals. It's about finding solace and connection in dark and desperate times. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. As we turn to the fight over corporate taxes, President Biden's proposed scrapping his plan to raise the corporate tax rate if Republican lawmakers agree to support at least $1 trillion in infrastructure spending. Biden had previously called for rolling back Trump's corporate tax cuts by increasing the rate from 21% to 28%, but he is now offering to keep Trump's tax cut and shrink the size of his infrastructure proposal in exchange for a minimum 15% tax rate for all companies. This all comes as President Biden's heading to the G7 meeting in Britain, where he's expected to push for a global minimum tax rate to make it harder for companies to stash their earnings in tax havens. Still with us, Jeffrey Sachs, director of the Center for Sustainable Development at Columbia University. So your comments on what's happening here in the United States and also the corporate overall tax rate. You are very critical of Biden for not his original infrastructure plan, but what he's doing now with the Republicans.
Well, I was shocked and dismayed and hope that it doesn't go anywhere. But the corporations have had an unbelievable run of unjust and unaffordable tax cuts. That's true for decades. The corporate taxes right now collect a little bit more than 1% of GDP in a booming period of corporate profits. In other words, we've given away the store. The Republicans especially gave away the store in 2017. President Biden said, okay, we'll restore half of what was given away. It's still leaving the companies effectively with a tax cut from 35% to 28% under Biden's plan. And then yesterday, apparently, he said to the Republicans, well, maybe we'll leave it at 21%. God, I hope that this doesn't happen. It would be the biggest single defeat for basic social justice and affordability of what we need to do through government that I can imagine, because everybody that looks at this understands that what was given away to the corporations was both unjust and unaffordable. And so Biden's plan, well, it was only partial, at least pointed in the right direction. Why did he put that on the table? He didn't even have a deal. What kind of negotiating is that? And of course, this is because we are a plutocracy. We are a corporate-driven society. Our infrastructure is crumbling, and the companies say, yeah, build the infrastructure, but don't charge us for any of it. In the meantime, the CEOs are laughing at us because their compensation is now more than 300 times average workers. So please, President Biden, we put you in office to help fix this country, not to continue with the Trump plan, for God's sake. It's simple. It's not even complicated. What is this negotiation about to preserve the Trump tax cut? That's why we had the 2020 election.
So what do you think it would take?
You know, part of the problem is we have two Democrats who are seemingly more Republican than Republican in this Senator's Sinema and Manchin. I don't get it, because Joe Manchin's constituents need this program perhaps more than any other state in the whole country. And Manchin's holding out, saying, I don't know. I don't want to vote for anything that the Republicans don't agree to. In the meantime, Mitch McConnell says his 100% effort is to destroy this administration and to preserve the Trumpisms of the last 4 years. So What is Manchin doing? Is he representing the people of West Virginia? Is he laughing? Is he a corporate shill? I don't get it. But this is what we're facing right now. This is a big issue for this country, because if we can't pay for the basic things we need, if we can't pay for a clean energy system, for safe water, for digital access of people who can't afford it, for a transport system that can work for the 21st century, and if the corporations say, count us out, we just love our billions and we don't want to put in anything. Well, what are we going to have as a country? And President Biden is there to turn this around. And he made a perfectly fine proposal. And he should take it to the American people and make the case. Because right now, all of the opinion polls show overwhelming American support for taxing the corporations, overwhelming American support for taxing the rich. It's probably the biggest consensus in this country. It's just not the consensus of the plutocrats in Congress, the Republican Party in the hands of billionaires. It's pretty simple stuff.
So
Biden should not be backing down.
So President Biden calls out Sinema and Manchin on Tuesday when he gave this Tulsa race massacre address in Oklahoma. And on Thursday, he caves to the Republicans, and Manchin and Sinema continuing to say they will not back off of supporting the filibuster. But let me take that corporate tax global. Your comment, finally, we just have about 30 seconds, on the G7 finance ministers agreeing to support a global minimum corporation tax rate. What would that mean globally?
Well, this is an important step. Let's make sure it's also not filled with the loopholes. The United States, the UK, Switzerland, Netherlands, and a very few other countries created a tax abuse system, which we call tax havens. It's a system for cheating. So they need to close it up. They made it, and they can stop it. And putting in a minimum tax for corporations so that they can't abuse all of us is a first step. So I'm hoping that this is real and that it's going to go through. It is an important positive step.
Jeffrey Sachs, I want to thank you for being with us, director of the Center for Sustainable Development at Columbia University, president of the UN Sustainable Development Solutions Network. Coming up, disaster patriarchy, how the pandemic's unleashed a war on women. We'll speak to V.
Juliak aslem kochina vil ya chumila tatsurikah tatsuriulev tatsu riashe
Existencia by Chumilka. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Disaster patriarchy, how the pandemic has unleashed a war on women. That's the headline of a new essay by V, the playwright and activist who was formerly known as Eve Ensler. She details how the pandemic has led to a surge in violence against women, as well as an economic and educational crisis, with tens of millions of women and girls out of work or school. UNESCO estimates 11 million girls may not return to school once the pandemic is over. Other estimates put the total as high as 20 million girls. In her essay, V writes, quote, COVID's revealed the fact that we live with two incompatible ideas when it comes to women. The first is that women are essential to every aspect of life and our survival as a species. The second is that women can easily be violated, sacrificed, and erased. V joins us now from Kingston, New York, founder of V-Day and 1 Billion Rising. This year marks the 25th anniversary of her play, The Vagina Monologues. Her new piece on disaster patriarchy appears in The Guardian. V, welcome back to Democracy Now! Thank you so much for joining us. Talk about disaster patriarchy.
Good morning, Amy, and thank you so much for having me.
Well, I would say Naomi Klein was the first to identify disaster capitalism. When capitalists use a disaster to impose measures they couldn't possibly get away with in normal times, generating more profit for themselves. I think that disaster patriarchy is a parallel and complementary process where men exploit a crisis to reassert control and dominance and rapidly erase the hard-earned rights of women. And I think I spent months interviewing activists and grassroots leaders all around the world, from Kenya to France to India, to find out how this process was affecting them and how they were fighting back. And in very different contexts, certain key factors kept coming up. One was that women are losing their safety, their economic power, their autonomy, their education, and they are pushed onto the front lines where they are often used, unprotected, and sacrificed. And I can sort of break that down if you want me to. I think if we look at intimate terrorism, otherwise known as domestic violence, has really turned home into a kind of torture chamber for millions of women around the world. I mean, we did a conference recently in France where domestic violence is out of control. We're seeing the same numbers in the U.S. RAIN was reporting, for example, that their hotlines have never been so busy. The same is true in Mexico. The same is true really in every country that I interviewed. And I think it's a combination of people feeling really severe economic insecurity, excess of alcohol, and this confinement has just made a perfect storm for abuse. It's hard really to determine, Amy, what is worse. The fact that men in 2021, thousands of men still feel willing and entitled to control, torture, and beat their wives and girlfriends and children, or that no government actually thought about this in thinking about their plans for lockdown. And I think we're also seeing just the outrage that is added to that, that many governments have reduced funding for shelters at the exact moment they were most needed. Very true throughout Europe and the U.S. In the U.K., providers have said that the crisis has exacerbated a lack of access to services for migrant and Black, Asian, and minority ethnic women. And organizations working with those communities say that persistent inequality leads to additional difficulties in accessing services such as education, healthcare, and disaster relief remotely. Then if we look at jobs, okay, in the U.S., more than 5 million women's jobs were lost between the start of the pandemic and November 2020, because much of the work that women do requires physical contact with the public, restaurants, stores, childcare, healthcare settings. Those were the first to go. And then again, there's the lack of childcare options, which have left many women unable to return to their jobs. By the way, having children does not affect men at all in the same way. And the rate of unemployment, for example, for Black and Latino women in the U.S. was high before the virus, but it's now even higher. And that situation is amplified in countries like India, where an activist there told me that 39.5% of women there had lost their jobs. Then there's the idea of working from home, where women's personal space has basically disappeared. Their workload has increased triple-fold. I don't think we can overstate how exhausting, how overwhelming the pandemic has been for women who really are not getting a break in any direction. And we know that when women are put under greater financial pressure, their rights erode. I was talking to women who were talking about the struggle to pay their rent, that they were being preyed upon by landlords. And there's a new process known as sextortion, where landlords are insisting that women have sex with them in order to pay their rent. And then, as you were saying earlier, and this is really disturbing to so many activists that I talked about, and I think it will have maybe the largest impact, is how many girls may not return to school. As you said earlier, between 11 and 20 million is the estimates. And I think this will be hugely, hugely problematic, because we know that when girls are educated, they know their rights, they know what to demand, And they have the possibility of getting jobs and taking care of their families. And when they have access to education and they don't have that access, they become a financial strain and they're forced into early marriages. They're sold off. Sex trafficking becomes much easier. I talked to one of our activists in Kenya who's been fighting to stop female genital mutilation there for over, you know, nearly 15, 20 years. And she said the pandemic has pushed girls back into their homes. They don't even know what's happening inside those homes because they don't have access to those girls. And we know when girls are cut, when they're female genitally mutilated, they no longer have access to education.
Yeah, I want to just bring in Malala Yousafzai's voice here. UNESCO predicting what 11 million, saying 11 million girls have left school could be as high as 20 million not returning. Malala Yousafzai is the winner of the 2014 Nobel Peace Prize. In 2012, she was shot in the head by a Taliban gunman who boarded her school bus. She survived serious wounds, now continues to campaign around the world for girls' education. Here, she's urging girls to return to school as soon as it's safe.
Whether your school is open or not, I hope you will do whatever you can to keep learning. Even though it may have been many months since you have been to school, don't lose hope and don't give up on your education. I know you have dreams and ambitions, and I believe you can make this world a better place. It all begins with education. So go back to your school as soon as it's safe.
Again, that's Malala Yousafzai, the Nobel Peace Prize winner. We continue as you talk about the ground women and girls are losing, and then what is being done, how people are resisting this, and what you think also governments need to do.
Well, I think the last area I want to really talk about is what's happening to frontline workers everywhere in the world. And during the pandemic, I was really honored and privileged to have a frontline seat to what's happening to nurses in America. I work with National Nurses United, as you know, one of the biggest and most effective and radical nurses unions in the country. And I interviewed many nurses on the front line. As a matter of fact, we created this beautiful piece called That Kindness out of those nurses, which was done at Brooklyn Academy of Music and then traveled across the country. And I watched for months as...
V, before you go on, I just wanted to play a clip from the docuplay, That Kindness, Nurses in Their Own Words, based on those interviews you talked about with nurses early on in the pandemic, the play produced in partnership with the National Nurses Union. This is actor Dale Soles.
We're not expendable. My family is not expendable. My husband is not expendable. My grandchildren are not expendable. My daughter works in the COVID unit. She goes straight home and showers immediately. She leaves her shoes outside, goes and showers, doesn't touch her kids, doesn't touch you, but goes and showers and packs her clothes so that they don't get exposed to what she was exposed to during the day. We have a saying in NNU, you save one life, you're a hero. You save 100 lives, you're a nurse.
An excerpt from the docuplay, That Kindness, made with National Nurses United. V, continue.
Well, I love that last little line. It's so brilliant. But, you know, so I watched for months, and I, as we all did, nurses having grueling 12-hour shifts, making agonizing choices and just acting as midwives to death, having to choose between who lived and who died. And then on their short lunch breaks, they had to protest over the fact that they had no personal protective equipment, which put them in even greater danger. I mean, we witnessed women wearing garbage bags for months instead of gowns and reusing masks that were infecting them and being forced to stay on the job with fevers, you know, in the same way that no one thought what it would mean to lock women up with children and women in houses with abusers. No one pre-thought what it would be like to send nurses into an extremely contagious pandemic without proper equipment. And that is a form of violence. Then again, I've talked to warehouse workers who packing and shipping with no protections, women who worked in poultry factories who were forced to work in close proximity, who had fevers, who were forced to keep going on the job.
And then, you know, I have worked for years with One Fair Wage. I just did a demonstration with them last week. Their salary is still $2.13 an hour, which it has been for the last 22 years. And now there's a new development called masculine harassment, which is that men are insisting women who are wearing masks, who are waiting on them, pull down their masks so they can look at their faces to determine if they're pretty enough to get a tip. Okay, these are just horrible notions and things that are escalating throughout the pandemic. I spoke to women farm workers in this country, Millie Trevina Sosita at Alianza, who tells me that female farm workers have more incidents of pesticide poisoning, sexual abuse, and heat stress because nobody is watching and no one has their eyes on them to protect them. And I think in the end, you know, as you said at the beginning, what COVID has revealed is that patriarchy is here. It hasn't gone away. It rises in disaster. And if we don't really address it now, if we don't say that we have to take it on full head as a system that is literally ruling and controlling our destinies throughout the planet, we're going to be spinning our wheels forever.
And so the resistance that people are organizing around the world, and you have always been a leader of that, talking about V-Day and the 25th anniversary of the vagina monologues, you're calling for a global initiative on the scale of the Marshall Plan to deconstruct, to exorcise patriarchy.
I think it's so critical. I want to say that I think one of the things, before I just get to addressing that, it's been so moving to see how many women are rising in the face of everything that's going on, in spite of risk of infection, in spite of poverty, in spite of horrible conditions in their communities. I mean, we saw in 1 Billion Rising this year, thousands of women rising. Our theme was 1 Billion Rising Gardens. Women planted gardens. I think there were 10,000 gardens that were planted, 9,000 in India, for example, across the whole country, but all over the world, women rose, women fought back, women stood up to governments, women demanded all kinds of protections in spite of the risk to their lives. But I want to say I've been doing this work for so long, 25 years and longer, every day, day in and day out. And if we don't really get to the root of what patriarchy is, we will be here forever. So I really am envisioning this large global initiative to deconstruct and exorcise patriarchy that would, first, we'd have to acknowledge it, that it's the root of so many other forms of oppression, from imperialism to racism, from transphobia to the denigration of the earth. And then there would be an ongoing education, public forums, processes, studying how patriarchy leads to those forms of oppression. We would use art to expunge trauma and grief and anger in the culture and help people heal and make people whole. And we would understand that a culture that has diabolical amnesia, which is certainly this country, and refuses to address its past, can only repeat its misfortunes and abuses. And I think we would have community and religious centers that dedicated to trauma. And we would study the arts of listening and empathy and reparations and apology. But we really have to say we need to focus on patriarchy as something real, as a system, and we need to dismantle it as a world.
The award-winning playwright, founder of V-Day and 1 Billion Rising, will link to your new piece in The Guardian, Disaster Patriarchy, How the Pandemic Has Unleashed a War on Women. I'm Amy Goodman. Be safe.